Okay, I do want to give a little heads up. Mary's out of town. Everybody knows Mary's last day will be, her last sermon will be July 31st. On July 30th, on that Saturday prior to that, we are planning a reception for her from 1:30 to 3:00 at the party room at the Red Bank Library, which is out on the highway right there. From 1:30 to 3:00, that will be on the 30th. We're just kind of reminding, starting to get a heads up on that. And then, of course, in our last sermon here will be on July 31st. And today, we are privileged to have a Zion Bell Choir, along with members of the St. Paul Bell Choir, to provide the regular class. Thanks for coming.
Thank you. gracious God, gentle new power, strong new faithfulness, you have breathed into us the breath of life. We thank you for loving the world into existence and sustaining all we are by your goodness. Through the power of your Holy Spirit, let us know anew the joy of Christ's living presence in us, the strength to face every circumstance of life.
Dear Lord, we know that you are always with us and for us, but sometimes we still forget to rely on your Holy Spirit who is in us to keep us on the right path. Show us your way, Lord, and the work you have for us to do. You brought us to this place and this time for such a time as this. We don't know what you have planned for us, but we are willing. When we cannot see the road before us, help us to trust in your faithfulness and to put our hope in you now and forevermore. Amen. Join me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Seven days for all the people, from the least to the greatest. Wine was served in goblets of gold, each one different from the other. And the royal wine was abundant. Queen Vashti also gave a banquet for the women in the royal palace of King Xerxes. On the seventh day, when King Xerxes was high in spirits from wine, he commanded his servants to bring before him Queen Vashti, so he could show her off to the people and nobles, for she was lovely to look at. But Queen Vashti refused to come, which made the king furious. As was the custom, the king consulted his wise men. According to the law, what must be done to Queen Vashti? She has not obeyed the command of King Xerxes. They replied, Queen Vashti has done wrong, not only against the king, but also against all the nobles and peoples of the provinces of King Xerxes. For the queen's conduct will become known to all the women, and they will despise their husbands and say, King Xerxes commanded Queen Vashti to be brought before him, but she would not come. This very day, the wives of the nobility who have heard about this will respond to the king's nobles in the same way. There will be no end to disrespect and discord. Therefore, if it pleases the king, let him issue a royal decree, which cannot be revoked, that Vashti is never again to enter the presence of King Xerxes. Also, let the king give her royal position to someone who is better than she. Then when the king's edict is proclaimed, all the women will respect their husbands, from the least to the greatest. The king and his advisors were pleased with this advice. So search was made for beautiful young virgins from every province to be brought to the king. The girl who pleased the king would be queen instead of Vashti. Now there was in the citadel of Susa a Jew of the tribe of Benjamin named Mordecai. Mordecai had a cousin named Esther, whom he had raised after her mother and father had died. Esther was lovely in form and features. When the king's order had been proclaimed, Esther was among the many girls who were brought to the palace, and she immediately won the king's favor. She did not reveal her nationality and family background because Mordecai had forbidden her to do so. Every day, Mordecai sat at the king's gate to find out how Esther was and what was happening to her. Now, the king was attracted to Esther more than any other woman, and he made her queen. About this time, he had promoted a man named Haman to command all the other nobles, which required everyone to bow down to him. Mordecai refused to bow to anyone other than his God, which so angered Haman that he vowed to destroy all Jews. He tricked the king into signing an irreversible ruling that would kill all Jews. Mordecai was alarmed and sent a message to Esther to go to the king and beg for mercy for her people. Esther replied that there was a law that any man or woman who went before the king without being summoned would be hanged. Mordecai sent back this answer. Do not think that because you are in the king's house, you alone of all Jews will escape. For if you remain silent at this time, relief and deliverance for the Jews will arise from another place, but you and your father's family will perish. And who knows? You may have come to the royal position for such a time as this. Esther sent this reply to Mordecai. Go, gather together all the Jews who are in Susa, and fast for me. Do not eat or drink for 3 days. I and my maids will fast as well. When this is done, I will go to the king, even though it is against the law. And if I perish, I perish. So Mordecai carried out all of Esther's instructions. In the message this morning, Thuerbach will tell you the rest of
I think most of us here remember when Paul Harvey's radio show was on, and where he always gave us the rest of the story. Well, here's our version of that. In the selection from the Book of Easter that Carl read, which is an adaptation of the scripture, you heard what led up to those words, "For such a time as this." Those are powerful words that hold a lot of meaning for us in St. Paul right now. The interesting thing about that book is, Esther is, the name of God never appears in it. Yet, however, his hand is evident in every page and in every aspect of Esther's life. He orchestrated each event in such a way that Esther was in the right place at the right time to protect the Israelites from a Holocaust even greater than the horrible events we are aware of. In words that were read, we see the lavishly rich life of King Xerxes, how he lived, and the expectations he had for everyone around him. Queen Vashti would have no part when the king commanded her to come show off her beauty in front of his guests, who were probably inebriated anyway from the wine. Her courage cost her life and opened the way for Esther to become queen. The king was advised to ban Vashti from the palace forever and find a beautiful virgin who would be a better queen for him. Was it an accident that Mordecai, a Jewish man who had raised his beautiful cousin Esther from the time her parents had died, arranged for her to be one of the virgins brought before the king? Or that the king chose Esther as his new queen? And then there had to be this cruel man named Haman. He was second only to the king, but he hated the Jews, mainly because Mordecai, who said it could be would not bow to him. He said, "I am a Jew, and I bow only to no one but God." Now remember, Esther was a Jew also. And guess who was in the place to speak to the king? Esther knew that her life would be in danger if she appeared before the king without being summoned. And she told Mordecai she couldn't do that. He sent word back that just because she was in the king's house, that didn't mean her life would be spared. She would be killed. And who knows but that you have come to the royal position you are in for such a time as this. From that point on, there were many twists and turns that our sovereign God could accomplish, with a surprise ending that not even the author, fiction writer John Grisham could have imagined. If you haven't read the Book of Esther, I encourage you to. It's only 10 chapters and well worth the time it takes to read it. Although our situation here at St. Paul is far less dramatic, God is doing the same thing for us. He has orchestrated our move from our old building, which has become too big and unmanageable for us, and give us the opportunity to worship at Zion, which I think has been a real blessing for us. And our building is being used in a much larger way than we were able to do. Now known as the Westside Community Center, they have allowed us free space. Rick and his group have allowed us free space to use the kitchen, store our pots and pans, and everything else there, and continue, so we continue serving our neighborhood meals on Wednesdays and Saturdays. And the food service we have with the people of Wyoming. Plus, they are allowing other nonprofits to use the space there, including a food bank, clothing bank, recovery services, and more. The Gathering Church from downtown is being there as well. Although we don't know how long we'll be worshiping here at Zion, it has worked out well for us as we search for a new location. cares about being in all of this? I believe the park is creating every move, and that he put us here for just a time as it is. That's a timely statement, but I think it's pretty exciting. We've taken some brave and enormous steps, but we prove that we are the church. Who are we?
We
are the church. And we're going to move forward and thrive as we wait for God to show us what's next. We could have just closed our doors and walked away as quite a few other churches have done, but not us. We are walking in faith, trusting in God's promise, and waiting on His time. His time. We've hired a new pastor, and even there, look what God did. He sent J.D. Grove to be our youth pastor some 15 so years ago. And he's sending him back to us now as a senior pastor. A coincidence? I don't think so. I look out here and I see Serenity and Hunter and their mother, Cal, over here. Serenity and Hunter came to us through Open Gym. Every time the kitchen crew prepares a meal for the neighborhood, they make all the sweet tea and work to all the other help to help prepare the food for them. They also help serve the food at our 12th Avenue location and at White Oak. We were there for them, and they've been here for us. We will never know how many lives our Open Gym program touched and changed the lives of those kids we don't know where God knows. Our volunteers from there are just behind the back. Sometimes we have to take risks and make scary choices. Like Esther said, if I perish, I perish. She trusted in God as we did and still are. I recently read about a place out in on the Oregon coast where there are huge rock formations jutting hundreds of feet above the sea. Every year on top of these pillars of stone, mother birds lay their eggs. I don't remember what bird it was. And as the babies grow, both parents tend to their needs. But soon comes the time for them to leave the nest. Floating on the water surface below, the fallers fall up to their offspring. The hatchlings, answering cries, fill the air as they realize what they must do. They'll need to leave their only home they've ever known and not return. And also, they've never flown and they've never even touched the ocean. These babies recognize their father's voice. Coaxing and encouraging them. One step at a time, they move closer to the end. At last, a single bird jumps, then another, then another. They will not be alone. This reminds me of how God called us from our comfort zone into leaps of faith. Much like those baby birds, though we are tempted to stay on the edge, our faith gets stronger every step we take. And as we continue to step off into the unknown, into His will, we can be confident Jesus will be there to catch us and teach us how to ride life's wave. Do you know how amazing you are and how many people are watching St. Paul to see what we'll do next? We're kind of the trailblazer as we reimagine ourselves. We'll hang on to the best of the past and remain open to what God is doing. Wouldn't it be nice We walk by faith, not by sight. That's who we are. I look back at the lives that Jan and I have lived. We met well by accident at St. John's, really, just a couple blocks here. That was nearly 70 years ago. We were both in the Christmas pageant. She was Mary and I was in Peter. And I was not a very nice man. But when they came to me and wanted to stay, I told them, there's no girl that's pregnant and unmarried going to stay at my place. But guess what? They, a couple of people there convinced me to take her home after two girls. And the rest of the story is history. We've been teen now for 66 years. Sometimes we get in over our heads because all this was true. I remember the first bishop group we ever went on. Tom Huff, who had the opening here, was in our Sunday school class that we had started, and a man he worked with had wanted us to go with him to Jamaica to pour concrete floor for a new church there. Now, Tom was a good concrete finisher, and they really needed him, but he wouldn't go unless his wife Lisa would go. And she wouldn't go unless Jan and I. Well, we all went. We had never done anything like that before. We prayed about the law. God said, just do it. It was an unforgettable experience. After a week of working side by side with the men and women of the little church in Hempstead, Jamaica, and lots of their precious, ever precious children, we were with. We could talk for days about the amazing experience we had there. How Jan and Lisa led a Bible study with the ladies while the men were trying to arrange for pouring concrete. Things weren't going well. We kept running into major obstacles. Things like the two of them we took with us were stuck at the border. They wouldn't let them come in. All kinds of things. So, we were really stuck. And Jan and them decided they would bring the ladies over and to add a little of those foster. And they would pray over this home. Well, that not only led to that we took them to a 4x4 we had there, made a big 6-foot cross out of it, buried in the ground where the new church was going to be. And then we wanted everybody to sign their name on that cross. So everybody working there, us, the Jamaicans, the kids even signed down where they could reach. We have dedicated that place for a church. I remember a Jamaican man there, I think his name was Roy. I don't remember his name, I think it was Roy. Who also wanted to sign his name to the cross. However, it became obvious by watching him, he didn't know how to write. I took his large black pen in mine, and we wrote his name. I'll never forget that name. Just the time. The more we had completed, everybody signed that cross. The first concrete truck came in that we had been waiting on all day long. The missionary there that we went with told us when we were leaving after we were getting ready to board and go on. He said, you know, the work you did here was great. And the love you shared with these people was wonderful. But the real blessing will be if you leave here guess it worked, because Jim and I went on to work on 5 mission trips to Gulfport after Hurricane Katrina. Then to the Pine Ridge Lakota Indian Reservation in South Dakota. And he became leader of that trip. And the man who led it for years was unable to continue. We did that for 10 years. God took us to Jamaica. Or also took us to Pine Ridge. I think there's no doubt the St. Paul Church of Christ is right here, right now, for such a time as this. As we pray for guidance with open hearts and open minds, may we walk forward, walk hand in hand with the Lord, to experience why we are here for such a time as this. Amen.
And now it's time for invitation to offering. So Lord, we come to you now with grateful hearts to return to you just a small portion of all the many gifts you have given us.
God knew Daniel that handled the lions. He knew David that handled the lion. He knew Esther that handled Haman. And he knows that you and I can handle whatever challenges we face as we move forward in faith. He created us specifically for such a time as this. Ephesians 3:20 says it all. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than we can ask or imagine, according to the power of the Holy Spirit in us, to him be glory to the church and in Christ Jesus through all generations forever and ever. Go now in peace, knowing that God is in control and he's got us right where he wants us. Amen.